our second panel of the morning is going to deal frontally with something that we touched upon tangentially before this conference, the question of terrorism and international human rights. It's a real pleasure to turn the podium now over to my colleague, Professor Larry Helfer. Larry, over to you.
Thank you, Scott, and thank you all for participating in today's conference at such a high level of discussion. I want to make sure that we're going to have plenty of time for back and forth Q&A with the members of the audience, and so I'm really looking forward to that. But before we have that, I'm also very much looking forward to the remarks of our three distinguished panelists. When I agreed to organize a panel on international human rights law and terrorism, these three individuals came to mind right away, in part because of the breadth of their experience, the degree to which each of them on the subject of the intersection of international human rights law and terrorism have written extensively influential and thought-provoking articles, have engaged in advocacy and litigation, wearing various hats, some governmental, some non-governmental. And I really can't do justice to their achievements, but I will introduce each of them before they make their remarks and speak for about 15 minutes or so on the specific topic. And so just to give you a brief overview of that, to my immediate left is Edward J. Flynn, who is the senior human rights officer of the Counterterrorism Committee Executive Directorate, which is a subsidiary body of the UN Security Council set up in the wake of 9/11. He has had a number of distinguished positions within the United Nations human rights system, with the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights as a field officer in Yugoslavia, and previous postings in other regions. And he will introduce for us, or provide a framework for us, for analyzing the ways in which international human rights concerns are incorporated into the United Nations approach to counter terrorism measures. After that, and I'll turn it over to Vijay in a moment, we will then look at a series of discrete issues that lie at the intersection of U.S. practice and international human rights law, with next to my left, Professor Douglas Cassel, talking about torture and cruel and human degrading treatment or punishment, interrogations and military commissions, among other issues. And then immediately to his left, Professor Vijay Padmanabhan will speak about a number of areas in which non-state actors are not directly regulated by existing international law, but where there has been some claim that international human rights law could serve as a kind of gap filler. And I hope, with respect to all that discussion, to re-engage some of the questions that were animating the last panel about where we go from here. So I will say more about the second and third speakers when we turn to their remarks, but for now I would like to begin the presentations with Edward Flynn, the Senior Human Rights Officer of the Counterterrorism Committee's Executive Director.
Thank you, Larry. By the way, you can call me EJ. It's okay. This is what I go by. I'm delighted to be here. Thank you very much to the Center and to Professor Silliman for inviting us to participate in this fascinating event. I've learned a great deal of direct utility for our work in New York, and I'm really pleased to be here. I would like to just, I need to follow the precedent set by our colleague Mary Perry from the Department of Defense, in the sense that since I do work for an organization that is rather sensitive on these important issues of terrorism and human rights, namely the Security Council and its Counterterrorism Committee. Of course, I'm not speaking on its behalf, and I'm offering only my own private remarks on this issue. The UN and the Security Council offer a fascinating forum in which to look at these issues, of course, because we deal with the very complex legal challenges that have been discussed over the last day and a half, but we're also obviously in a highly political context, and I must say it's been a great privilege for me to have been able to see how some of these issues have been thrashed out in the last few years at the Security Council level in terms of the applicability and relevance of international human rights law to the international effort against terrorism. The good news is that I have found, I think it's very clear, that the Security Council, like hopefully any properly functioning political body, is amenable to pressure and to the efforts of advocates and proponents of particular kinds of points of view, and does change its policy in response to pressure, not only from member states, but from international organizations and indeed civil society. The bad news is that it does also, of course, appear to many to operate with a certain degree of arbitrariness, which is inevitable. I think it was Professor Glenn who spoke about the agreements that are made in the corridors behind the Security Council. And ultimately, of course, the Security Council operates on the basis of the Charter, which does invest it with this remarkable and unique place at the pinnacle of international law in many respects. I'd like to first address that question briefly. I will tell you in just a moment, for those who aren't familiar with the counterterrorism machinery, about exactly where I work and the body that I support along with a team of colleagues. But I want to deal first with the question of the applicability of international human rights law to the Security Council itself and to the actions taken in its resolutions, which has been crystallized, as I'm sure many of you know, in a fascinating way in terms of the targeted sanctions regime applied principally, well, with regard to terrorism by Resolution 1267 of 1999 and by subsequent initiatives by the Security Council to sanction individuals associated with Al-Qaeda or the Taliban. And Resolution 1267, please forgive me, I'm sure some of you are well familiar with this, but it did create the system of listing of individuals alleged to be associated with those two entities. And the question has come up in quite a pointed manner as to the obligations of the Security Council to respect human rights in listing individuals. It's been a gradual process, but ever since 1999, a number of observers have noted that this whole system manifests serious deficiencies in terms of due process, because the way in which the Security Council identifies individuals to put on this list is by receiving proposals from member states, from considering the proposals in closed session, and if there is no objection, then by proceeding to list those individuals. And the consequences, of course, are severe. There are, first of all, freezing of assets imposed, travel ban, also prohibitions on the ability to deal in the weapons trade. But it's mainly the financial and the travel ban which are issues of interest. And so there's been a question about the Security Council's obligations in this respect. And you can look, and many courts have looked to the provisions of the Charter, which I hope is not quite so far in desuetude as Professor Glennon suggested in the earlier presentation. I still carry it around in any case. And I think, of course, it is our guiding Charter. The Security Council is bound to act in conformity with the purposes and principles of the United Nations, among which in Article 1, of course, are to promote respect for human rights and fundamental freedoms, and also to ensure that that their efforts to bring about the resolution of threats to international peace and security are in conformity with the principles of justice and international law. Well, General Assembly, the world's heads of state in the 2005 World Summit Declaration produced probably the most compelling proclamation calling upon the Security Council to ensure that its listing regime respect human rights obligations, including due process. And it's interesting that the term due process is often used in this context, even though that's rather a U.S. concept. But the world's heads of states in 2005 called on the Security Council to adopt fair and clear procedures in its sanctions process. And this was the culmination of a lot of pressure being put on the Council. But of course, the Council, you know, to whom does the Council answer ultimately? Well, the issue has been rather resolved in the sense that a number of courts, particularly regional courts in Europe, have taken up the question of the listing process and have wrestled with legal formulations by which to essentially constrain Council action where it can be seen to violate principles of due process. And it has, the European courts have tried to use a number of formulations, including assessing whether or not the Council, for example, in the sanctions regime, has violated norms of Hughes-Cogan's. But since the issues, the questions at issue here were matters such as the right to fair trial and the right to property, the courts have not accepted the idea that Hughes-Cogan's is necessarily at issue here. But the European Court of Justice, a very important decision in 2008, in the Cadi decision, took a decision which essentially annulled action taken by the European Council in implementation of Resolution 1267. And the court was quite clear in saying that it was not challenging the primacy of United Nations Security Act Council action under Article 103 of the Charter, but rather was focusing on the implementation of those sanctions by the European Union, which itself is subject, of course, to a very strict and comprehensive human rights regime. And this occasioned great interest and indeed concern in the halls of the United Nations and the Security Council, because in a way this was a direct challenge to the authority of the Security Council on human rights grounds to take action against terrorism. The Council has, perhaps later I can mention a couple of other decisions which have addressed this issue, but the Council has been wrestling with this issue and has adopted a number of measures. Many human rights advocates and states have considered them insufficient to deal with this problem. The Council has, for example, called upon the Secretariat of the 1267 Committee to publish short summaries of essentially statement of cases against individuals alleged to be they established a focal point to receive requests for delisting, but they never really rose to the level of the ultimate challenge and the fundamental demand of many, which was to establish some sort of a independent oversight body of Security Council action to review listing. And I should say that, of course, the great majority of people and entities listed on this list are no doubt affiliated some of the stories that one hears of the difficulties they have encountered in their lives because of Security Council action are quite moving. The Council, I think, considers that it may have settled this question just last December, a few months ago, with Resolution 1904, in which they took the significant and interesting step of creating an ombudsman institution, or an individual, essentially, with a short list, with a small staff, who would receive complaints, requests for delisting, assess them, and then essentially not make a decision that would bind the members of the Council, but would lay out the arguments for the Security Council closing the 7th Committee on removing someone from that list. Interesting in that there was, therefore, a means by which Security Council action was affected, in this case by European human rights jurisprudence and UN as well as that. Remains to be seen where that will go. The ombudsman has not yet been appointed. I work in support of subsidiary body called the Counterterrorism Committee, established by Resolution 1373, adopted in September 2001, just after the 9/11 attacks, and which is considered historic in a legal sense, certainly in the sense that that resolution imposed legal obligations under Chapter 7 of the Charter on all countries in the world to take certain specified actions against terrorism, particularly in the areas of prevention and financing of terrorism, criminalization of terrorist offenses, and bringing terrorists to justice and international legal cooperation. So what we do is assess what states are doing in implementing Resolution 1373. The question here has been, to what extent is the Counterterrorism Committee constrained or bound by human rights obligations of states? And in the early days, in the first years after 2001, there was quite a great deal of criticism of the CTC for proceeding in its dialogue with states. It received reports from states and then responded essentially by bypassing the human rights question. And essentially, as the UN Special Rapporteur suggested, telegraphing to states that human rights was not a great concern in their counterterrorism measures. But there was a lot of pressure on the CTC, again, another example of successive advocacy, to include human rights in its assessment of counterterrorism measures. And High Commissioner for Human Rights, Mary Robinson, made a public call in quite a few states as well. And when they created our office, the council agreed with the idea that human rights should be part of our assessment of states' counterterrorism measures. And I can fast forward a bit. I also don't want to exceed my time, but I am pleased to be able to say today, I think it's quite true now that no state in the world is laboring under the misimpression Security Council is unconcerned with human rights issues in terms of implementation of Resolution 1373. And that is because the CTC and my office, as Larry said, the Executive Directorate, do now make robust reference to relevant human rights issues in our dialogue with states, in our visits to states. And there's been a fascinating process really over these last 4.5 years since CTED was created, seeing how far council members were willing to go in conducting a human rights analysis as part of their overall critique. And the limits set essentially by council members and by particular members of the council more than others is that they are willing to accept an inquiry into human rights as long as the inquiry is strictly relevant to Resolution 1373 and also to our second resolution, 1624, which I'll mention just briefly in a moment. But with respect to 1373, I mentioned some of its provisions, and we have engaged in this process of identifying and working with the committee to identify issues that it considers relevant to implementation of the resolution. And therefore, for example, there are about 5 or 6 areas which I can perhaps get into in more detail later, but for example, I mentioned that criminalizing terrorist offenses is a requirement under the resolution. The principle of legality. We now directly discuss with states the precision with which they have criminalized terrorist offenses and the danger that has been noted by UN mechanisms and many others of overbroad definitions which could give states the latitude to punish legitimate conduct, for example, freedom of speech, political dissent, a number of states in their criminal laws, for example, as part of their terrorist offenses would subject acts affecting the social order or stability as terrorist offenses, and one could, I think the question was raised earlier, what exactly does that mean? And so we look at questions of precision. We also look at questions of what states do to bring terrorists to justice. I think in that sense, the remarks by my colleagues on the panel will be interesting because we are engaged in discussion on these issues, such as the nettlesome question of preventive detention that was raised by security measures which contemplate preventive detention with oversight which arguably is not independent. And in those states, we have questioned whether or not the preventive detention regimes do comply with states' human rights obligations. I'm going to jump ahead just in the interest of time. Just take about two more minutes later. I don't want to overuse my time. But I'd like to refer to the second resolution we deal with, Resolution 1624, which I mentioned briefly yesterday, which considerably expands the scope of action that the Security Council takes in its dialogue with states. That resolution, which was not a Chapter 7 resolution, addresses specifically the question of incitement to commit acts of terrorism. It was adopted in September 2005. It had been pushed by the United Kingdom just after the London bombings, and obviously the concern was this threat posed by advocacy of the commission of terrorist acts. Needless to say, the resolution squarely comes up against the obligation to respect the right to freedom of expression. That's one reason the resolution was adopted under Chapter 6, because the U.S., in this case, was uncomfortable with the potential free speech implications. But it has been, the resolution has provided us with an opportunity to look not only into 1373 issues, which deal with really tough criminal law enforcement and the apprehension and punishment of terrorists, but also the preventive aspect. And in that sense, discuss with states how they protect and promote the right to freedom of expression while taking measures against dangerous and unlawful incitement. And the resolution also has some very interesting provisions on promotion of dialogue among cultures and the countering of extremism and intolerance. So it's rather remarkable that we were able to get into these questions from a Security Council platform. Just as the last point I'd like to raise, these preliminary remarks is that the Security Council's approach on counterterrorism is quite distinguishable from that which was taken a few years ago by the General Assembly in its adoption unanimously of a global counterterrorism declaration, or strategy, I should say, in 2006, in which the General Assembly first of all, reaffirmed the importance of the relevant Security Council resolutions, but placed terrorism in a much broader context and, rather remarkably, also included the concept of, quote-unquote, conditions conducive to terrorism, such as human rights violations, discrimination, poor governance, marginalization of certain communities, etc. And it also expressly endorsed or affirmed the necessity to take human rights aspects of counterterrorism into account. And I just want to say that there have been so many fascinating presentations here, but Ambassador Rikawa's comments last night I thought were very interesting in terms of giving us the direct experience of one member state in implementing a counterterrorism strategy that has incorporated, of course, not only enforcement provisions, but also which has promoted the importance of strengthening respect for human rights, promoting inclusion, promoting women's rights, and happily, and one hopes for a long time to come, Morocco seems to have escaped the worst effects of terrorism, and there may be some very valuable lessons to learn there for both the UN and for member states. I think I'll stop there. I'm sure we'll have a chance to get into other issues.
Thank you very much, Vijay. Our next panelist is Doug Cassel, who is the Notre Dame Presidential Fellow and Director for the Center for Civil and Human Rights at Notre Dame Law School. In addition to being a prolific scholar and commentator on issues of international human rights, international criminal law, and international humanitarian law, Doug has also held numerous advisory positions with UN bodies
Thank you, Larry, and thank you, Scott Silliman, for organizing this marvelous conference. I join everyone else in congratulating you on the quality of the presentations. My topic is to look at the record of the Obama administration with regard to human rights in counterterrorism activities. The record, I would say, is decidedly a mixed one. In making that statement, I recognize, of course, that this administration, like any other, faces some serious difficulties in attempting to respect human rights and at the same time to combat terrorism. First of all, this administration has inherited a great deal of baggage from the prior administration in the form of Guantanamo military commission trials, a past record of torture, cruel and human and degrading treatment, all of which now needs to be overcome in order to set us on the right course. Secondly, the inherent difficulty of the subject matter. With the best of intentions to follow domestic and international law in all respects, it is not always clear where to draw the line. And thirdly, the law, both domestic and international, is replete with legal gaps and ambiguities, as we have heard in a number of contexts. Against these difficulties, one must credit the Obama administration for a number of clear positive steps, among them banning torture and cruel and human and degrading treatment by all agencies of the U.S. government, closing the so-called CIA black sites, removing the CIA from security interrogations, better policies with regard to security detentions, extraordinary renditions, and military commissions. But even so, there are many problems affecting all of these areas. Time today will not permit me to address all of them, but I will try to discuss at least two and maybe three. First, I'll speak about torture and CID. Secondly, about military commissions, and if time permits, I may have a word on security detentions, but if I don't get there, I understand that Vijay is going to focus on that subject. First of all, with regard to torture and CID, as is well known, excuse my voice, I left it in Ireland earlier this week. In January of last year, 2009, the president issued an executive order banning, or at least which is advertised to ban, torture and CID. And in August of last year, after a working group went through a review process, Attorney General Eric Holder announced in a one-page press release and a press conference that the policy of the United States government is now that the Army Field Manual techniques, and only those techniques, are available for all U.S. government agencies engaging in interrogations. Yet there remain four problems with these two positive steps. First, their legal status. The January 9 executive order is only that, an executive order. It can be reversed by the stroke of a pen by the next president, just as this president reversed the policies or the executive order of the previous president. The August of 2009 policy is even less. It's only a policy even more easily reversed than an executive order. Neither of these is legislation. There is some legislation on the books, but the primary legislation involved, the Detainee Treatment Act of 2005, has some crucial loopholes in it. If that were not the case, there would not have been a need for the president to issue the new executive order. Second problem is ambiguity. If you read the January executive order literally, it appears to ban torture and CID only in armed conflict, a little noticed aspect of the executive order. What about combating terrorism in situations outside armed conflict? And there are many such situations. One would like to think that torture and CID are banned in those contexts, but it is certainly not clear from the text of the executive order. What about the August policy extending the Army Field Manual techniques limitations to all agencies of the U.S. government? Does that apply only in armed conflict? Well, some people in this room probably know because they read it, but I'm outside the government and I haven't seen it, and it's not public. And all we have is a one-page press release from the Attorney General of the United States, which does not make clear the answer to that question. That brings up the third problem, which is transparency. The August 2009 policy, like the other policies developed as a result of the working groups established January a year ago, is not public. We can only guess at what it says. We have to hope for the best. A fourth problem has to do with extraordinary renditions, which are otherwise phrased as outsourcing torture in CID. President Obama says they will continue, but with greater safeguards. What are those safeguards? How persuasive are they? To what extent do we continue to rely on assurances from countries like Syria that, oh no, they wouldn't torture someone rendered to their countries? Very difficult to evaluate, again, without greater transparency, which we have not had. Moving on now to military commissions. As you all know, we had a very good and lengthy discussion of that subject on the panel yesterday. But there's so many issues that arise with regard to military commissions that the panelists were not able to tag all of the bases. There was a great deal of discussion of the procedural rights and the various iterations of military commission frameworks since 2001 up to the present time, and a great deal of comparison of military commissions to federal criminal trials. But there was little time to address what I regard as two fundamental structural flaws in military commissions: discrimination and impartiality. Both of these flaws are either incurable, or if they are curable, it is only with great difficulty. The context of history is also a useful point of departure. The point was made yesterday that military commissions have a long history in the United States. Yes, they do, but it is not a glorious history. It is a history of unfair procedures and unjust outcomes. The Quirin case was essentially a rush to execution. History has not read that decision favorably. The Yamashita case was so flawed as to amount, arguably, to victor's justice. This is not a record on which to commend the use of military commissions. It is not, therefore, surprising that they have not been used in the United States or in any other democratic country, to my knowledge, since World War II. Since that, except for the current incarnation under the Bush and now the Obama administrations, since that last use in the World War II era, three modern developments have rendered the historical use of military commissions arguably obsolete. First is the Uniform Code of Military Justice in 1951. Second, the development of the whole body of international human rights law in the post-war period. And thirdly, the great advances in international humanitarian law beginning in 1949 and continuing. Now that brings me to these fundamental structural principles of discrimination and impartiality. Both of them are pervasive in international human rights law. They are required by the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, a treaty to which the United States is a party, and which I'll call the ICPR. They are required by every regional human rights treaty, and arguably they are fundamental principles of customary international law. In my view, they also are both basic elements of the Common Article 3 requirement of, quote, the judicial guarantees which are recognized as indispensable by civilized peoples, end quote, and therefore are applicable in IHL as well. First, let's look at discrimination. The 2001 executive order from President Bush initially establishing military commissions, and also the 2006 and 2009 Military Commission Acts passed by Congress, all have one thread in common. Military commissions can be used only to prosecute foreign nationals and not U.S. citizens. For anyone outside the United States, a rather obvious question arises. If military commissions are all as fair and just as we are told they are, then why do Congress and the President allow their use only against foreigners and not against Americans? Mary Perry made the point yesterday, if I heard her correctly, that the main objection she hears from our friends and allies overseas is this very point of discrimination, that military commissions are a sort of second-class trial for non-U.S. nationals. But this discrimination not only undermines what Jay Johnson yesterday referred to as the necessary credibility for trials of suspected terrorists, it is also arguably a violation of international human rights law. The International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, the ICPR, bars discrimination in the administration of justice on the basis of a number of criteria, including, quote, other status, end quote, which has been interpreted by the British House of Lords to include discrimination on the basis of nationality. Customary international law likewise bans discrimination in the administration of justice on the basis of nationality. Now, under international law, distinctions in treatment can be allowed, but only where there is an objective and a reasonable justification for the distinction in treatment. For example, we don't allow foreign citizens to vote in the United States elections, generally speaking, for obvious reasons. But foreign citizens are equally entitled, as are American citizens, to the essential safeguards of a fair criminal trial. This was brought out in a decision by the British House of Lords in 2004 in the case of A versus Secretary of State. At issue was a British preventive detention system which applied to, I think at that point, fewer than a dozen people, all of whom were foreign nationals, and this preventive detention system was not available for UK nationals. The British law lords applied the standards of the European Court of European Convention of Human Rights, but it also recognized that those are the very same standards as those applicable under the ICPR, the treaty to which we too are states parties. The British court found no reasonable and objective justification for allowing preventive detention of foreign nationals but not of UK citizens, and ruled the scheme was incompatible with the European Convention on Human Rights. In response, the government of Tony Blair and Parliament came up with a new scheme applicable equally to UK and foreign citizens. Now, could the United States do the same? In other words, could we authorize trial by military commissions not only of foreign, but also of United States citizens? Maybe Congress would approve it. But if so, would imposing military commission trials on American citizens accused of terrorism be constitutional? That's very doubtful. It's true, as Scott Silliman mentioned yesterday, that the Kieran case allowed the use of a military commission against an American dual citizen in 1943. But that was, first of all, in an undoubted international armed conflict, and secondly, much has happened since then. For example, in 1957, in Reed versus Covert, the Supreme Court ruled that the Constitution prohibits trial by court-martial of U.S. civilians accused of offenses against the U.S. So unless you can characterize someone accused of a terrorist offense of being a combatant of one sort or another, if that person is a civilian under Reed versus Covert, he or she may be entitled to the full protection of all rights under the U.S. Constitution, including the right to speedy trial. In 2004, even for an American citizen accused of being an unlawful enemy combatant, the Supreme Court, in an opinion by Justice Scalia, and with an 8-1 vote, ruled that Yasser Hamdi, a dual U.S. citizen, was constitutionally entitled to due process of law. And finally, in a unanimous ruling in Crawford versus Washington in 2004, the Supreme Court strengthened the right of the accused to confront the witnesses against him, despite state law exceptions to the hearsay rule. Now, all of these cases may be debatable, but one or more of them would pose significant potential hurdles, and certainly ammunition for defense counsel representing any U.S. citizen who might be brought before a military commission trial. And under international human rights law, if U.S. citizens have these rights before a military commission, so too must foreign citizens. Let me turn now to the second fundamental structural principle of impartiality. The ICPR, customary international law, and Common Article 3 also require that criminal trials be conducted before impartial judges. The international law test for impartiality is twofold. One prong is subjective. Is there evidence of actual bias on the part of the judge? That hardly ever happens. That prong is rarely used. But there's an alternative that is much more commonly used, and that is the objective prong, where the question is whether there is an appearance of a lack of impartiality. In other words, whether a neutral observer could reasonably question the impartiality of the judge given the circumstances. In other words, as the common law has long said, justice must not only be done, but must be seen to be done. Now, yesterday the point was made that the procedures for military commission trials in the Military Commissions Act of 2009 are almost as good as court martials. Now, I respect courts martial. I served as a JAG officer, and in that capacity, I tried something like 200 cases before courts martial. But there is a fundamental difference between courts martial and military commissions. Courts martial are used to prosecute U.S. service members. Military commissions are used to prosecute our alleged enemies. It is one thing for U.S. military officers and enlisted to sit in judgment of their own personnel in a court martial. Quite another for them to sit in judgment of their enemies in military commissions. This point is little noticed in the United States, but is plain to much of the world, for whom a U.S. military trial of an Al-Qaeda enemy accused would no doubt give reason to question the appearance of impartiality of the judges. Now, I want to be very careful in what I say next, but I think it's worth bringing up. I want to refer to the opening remarks made yesterday by Assistant General Counsel Mary Parrott of DOD. In prefacing her support for trials by military commissions, she invoked, and I tried to take this down verbatim, quote, "seeing and feeling the loss of my colleagues on the battlefield," end quote. She candidly acknowledged that her views on military commissions are based partly on her, quote, "emotionally invested opinions," end quote. Now, in my view, these sentiments are admirable in human terms and in patriotic terms. One would expect almost any U.S. service member to share those sentiments, and one would applaud them for doing so. But they also illustrate why an objective observer might have a reasonable doubt as to the appearance of impartiality of a court composed of U.S. military officers. Even though JAG officers, former JAG officers, military personnel, would no doubt do their utmost to rule in an utmost and professional manner, the issue remains one of appearances. This is a structural problem. It cannot be fixed by procedural tinkering. As long as military commissions involve U.S. military personnel sitting in judgment of their presumed enemies, the issue of an appearance of impartiality reasonably would arise. How am I doing on time here? Do I have time to say
a minute or two?
Okay, that brings me to my third topic, which is security detention. I know that EJ is going to speak much more about that, but let me just say briefly on that subject that security detention is something which needs to be viewed with the utmost caution. Yes, one can easily articulate situations in which it might be perceived to be needed, but one can equally envision, and we have many examples of this around the world today, of the overuse and the abuse of security detention. It easily becomes an instrument of repression. And therefore, if it is to be allowed at all, it must be allowed only with extreme caution and accompanying safeguards. Now, international human rights law provides some boundaries, particularly procedural boundaries, on preventive detention, but not enough, and you'll hear more about that from Vijay. But when I refer just then to international human rights law, I'm talking about global human rights law. There is another model of international human rights law which is worth bearing in mind, and that is the European model. Under the European Convention on Human Rights, as interpreted by the European Court of Human Rights, preventive detention for security purposes is prohibited. It can be done, if at all, and it's not clear whether the if at all applies, under a derogation from the European Convention on Human Rights. Now, derogations have real advantages that should be taken into account. A derogation is a formal public statement by a government notified to the appropriate international authority and authorized by the treaty in question that for a limited period of time, to a limited extent, with respect to certain rights that are allowed to be derogated, the government will not fully comply with the rights as set forth in the treaty. Using, if we're going to do any sort of security detention at all, using that sort of approach, where a government must publicly explain the reasons for a temporary departure, where there's a built-in sunset clause on it, seems to me to be a much better way to go than to write into law a tool which is permanently and regularly available to any government which wants to use it at a given moment in time. There's much more to say on that, but I did want to make at least that much of a suggestion before I pass the floor to Vijay, who I understand is going to focus on issues of preventive detention. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Doug. Our third panelist is Vijay Padmanabhan, who is visiting assistant professor at Cardozo Law School, where he teaches courses on the laws of war and international human rights law. Previously, he was an attorney advisor at the U.S. Department of State for 5 years, where he was the department's chief counsel on Guantanamo and Iraq detainee litigation, and participated in, among many other cases, the path-breaking Supreme Court decisions of Hamdan, Boumediene, and Munaf. Vijay.
Thanks. Thank you so much, Larry, and also thanks to Scott for organizing this panel. It's my first time here at Duke, and the more time I spend here, I kind of wonder why everyone hates your basketball team. It's a pretty place, if nothing else. I'm actually going to depart from my planned remarks at the outset because I feel like I need to respond to something that Doug just brought up about military commissions. I'll say, quickly throw that out there and get into what I intended to talk about today. It seems like there has been a general inversion in the way that people think about the relationship between military trials, civilian trials, and court enemies. The Geneva Conventions contemplate that enemy combatants, meaning lawful combatants, enemy soldiers like our Nazi enemies or our Iraqi enemies, would be prosecuted in the same courts that we prosecute our own soldiers in, which in this case were courts martial. And yet the dialogue on both sides of this issue, I think, regularly seems to suggest that it's inappropriate to prosecute foreign enemies in military court and it makes sense to prosecute them in civilian court. When the conventions, of course, take exactly the opposite tack, for the reason that it's more likely that a U.S. service member, for example, would understand the circumstances of combat than would a U.S. civilian if the trial were to take place in a civilian court. And one other point that's I feel like I need to respond to is this notion that there is going to be an international difference in perceptions between trials conducted in U.S. civilian court and in military commissions, for example. And I think we need to parse out our foreign audiences. I certainly think it's the case that among European audiences, there may be a distinction drawn between military commissions and U.S. civilian courts, and European audiences may be more versed in the nuances of the U.S. legal system. But I think in the Arab world, in the Islamic world, very little difference exists in people's minds between military commissions in the Southern District of New York. To that audience, I think it's victor's justice regardless of which American venue chooses to prosecute the crimes. And so I am skeptical of basing our prosecution decisions on any sense of the kind of reaction we would get from the international community, because I don't think even prosecuting people in the federal courts is going to produce any sort of groundswell of understanding that this is a fair process. So, anyway, that's just by way of response to a couple of the comments. Now, as Doug suggested, I'm actually going to talk about a different topic, which is the suggestion that human rights law is the solution to challenges that the United States has faced in detention operations in the conflict with Al-Qaeda. And again, I'm going to be somewhat of a skeptic about the suggestion that human rights law is the solution to the gaps in law that have been identified. So let me explain the problem first, then lay out the specific questions I'm going to address, make some general observations about human rights law, and then dive into the questions. So the problem has been created by the fact that since 9/11, as we all know, the US has been involved in an armed conflict with Al-Qaeda. And while there has been some, there was some discussion immediately after the 9/11 attacks about what the nature of that armed conflict is, at least in the United States, the Supreme Court answered the question in Hamdan versus Rumsfeld by characterizing the conflict as not of an international character. Now, this is significant because while the court, by doing this, did bring Common Article 3 of the Geneva Conventions into legal application in the conflict with Al-Qaeda, it excluded the vast volume of Geneva Convention's protections from the particular conflict because those protections are designed for conflicts of an international character. And thus, the finding in Hamdan, while very helpful on treatment issues, such as the torture issues that Doug was just talking about, because Common Article 3 provides treatment protections for detainees, left open a whole series of important questions in detention operations. Because the very limited law that exists, both treaty and customary law on non-international armed conflict, really doesn't address three questions that I'm going to focus on today. First, who is subject to detention in a conflict with a non-state actor? Second, what process should that detainee receive in connection with the detention? And third, what legal obligations does the state have with respect to post-conflict repatriation? So the immediate response to these questions is, well, why are we discussing this in the human rights panel? We had the use of force law war panel just before us. Why was I not speaking in that panel? Well, the reason is because my specific focus is on whether human rights law can serve a gap-filling function with respect to these questions. And in fact, scholars and international organizations, NGOs as well, have made the argument that human rights law is an appropriate gap-filling body to look to because of the concept of complementarity. And complementarity holds that international legal obligations should be read in light of one another. And the idea here is that because both human rights law and the law of war operate coterminously, in situations where the law of war doesn't have an applicable rule, complementarity suggests that we can look to human rights law to serve to fill the gap. And indeed, such a conception is consistent with the view of lex specialis laid out by the International Court of Justice. Lex specialis says where there's a more specific rule, such as an armed conflict where the law of war provides a more specific rule, that rule should govern. But where there is no more specific rule, it would be natural to look to human rights law as the gap filler. Well, I think at the outset, there are four general problems that I identify with using human rights in this sort of way. First is, and Doug has already sort of alluded to this, there's a lack of uniform rules in human rights law. Unlike IHL, where there are a set of universally ascribed to treaties, human rights law is a patchwork of international and regional treaties with states joining a motley assortment of these treaties. So different countries have different sets of human rights obligations. So it's difficult to say, make blanket assertions about this is what human rights requires in a particular situation. And this problem makes assertions, the second point, makes assertions of custom very difficult, at least using the traditional model of custom, which looks for universal state practice as one of the pillars upon which to found custom. Now, there are more modern, perhaps, methodologies for describing norms as custom. I'm not going to get into that at this moment, but we can certainly discuss that in the Q&A. But at least under the traditional model, very difficult to assert that these human rights norms are customary. The third point is that it's difficult to assess the applicability of human rights norms extraterritorially. This is one of the most contested terrains of human rights law. The United States, for example, has taken the consistent position that the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, the ICCPR, does not apply extraterritorially. The Rights Committee, which is the monitoring body for the ICCPR, disagrees. Similar sort of disputes has existed about exactly what the sphere of application is of the European Charter. So there's always this discussion and difficulty of figuring out exactly how we draw from human rights. We're talking about conduct that takes place outside of the home country. And lastly, there's the issue of derogations. Most of the human rights treaties allow states to derogate in times of emergency. Well, the classic emergency is non-international armed conflict. And so one has to ask the question, exactly how much use one can get out of human rights norms if what states are going to do once they say they apply is to derogate from them because of the existence of conflict. So those are sort of my general observations or skeptical observations about whether human rights is really a useful gap-filling tool in these non-international armed conflicts. But I think these difficulties really sharpen when one looks at the specific questions that I raised at the outset. Now, I'll begin with the scope of detention authority. Now, the law of non-international armed conflict certainly contemplates detention, Common Article 3 and Additional Protocol 2 to the Geneva Conventions, to which the U.S. is not a party, contemplate detention, but they don't provide rules on who can be detained in armed conflict. And so one of the common suggestions you find is that we should then look to human rights law to fill the gap, and that human rights law can tell us who can be detained in these conflicts. But I ask, what human rights are we talking about? Well, one model is the prosecute or release model. And as Doug suggested, this is the model of the European Treaty. But it's not the model for the United States, which is not party to the European Treaty, obviously, and is party to the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, which explicitly allows for administrative detention, provided that the detention is not arbitrary. Arbitrary means that there must be a legitimate government purpose underlying that detention. Now, the difficulty is, first, that security detention will generally be a legitimate government purpose. So describing something as a security detention almost per se puts it into the category of an appropriate human rights law detention. And the second is that there's been no meat developed on the bones of what arbitrary means in this context. The Human Rights Committee, for example, has not created a searching jurisprudence that would ask the question of who is appropriate to be detained for security purposes, and what are the procedures associated with that. So it's fine to say that human rights law, we should look to human rights law to answer this question, but the difficulty is ascertaining exactly what human rights law actually restricts with respect to state conduct. And that becomes even clearer when we shift to the second question of process, because there again, the law of non-international armed conflict contemplates detention, but it doesn't specify procedures for detention of enemy fighters. And so it seems natural to look to human rights law, which is focused on procedural questions in domestic legal systems. But again, I think you find that human rights law is inadequate when we actually bear down on what human rights law has to say. The prosecutor or release folks will say, well, there's a very simple set of procedures or a well-established set of procedures that you should look at, which is trial procedures. Well, I think the first thing that comes to my mind is that arguing that wartime detentions need to be conducted consistently with peacetime trial rules is inconsistent with the concept of complementarity that I laid out at the outset. Law of war framework specifically contemplates detention, security-based detention. So to say that human rights law steps in and says security detention can only take place after trial is inconsistent with this mutually reinforcing concept of these two bodies of law. The ICCPR suggests that for administrative detention, the applicable procedures are notice to the detainee of the reasons for detention, plus judicial review of that detention. Now, this should be very familiar to all of us because this is essentially where we've ended up in Guantanamo with the habeas model, where we provide notice and then judicial review, maybe not prompt judicial review, but judicial review of the legality of the detention. But I think human rights law has several questions to ask or questions to answer about this model. Is it practical with larger numbers of detainees to expect courts to hear claims as to the legality of detention? And what's the content of this review? Human rights law doesn't specify what the standards are that should be employed in the review, both substantively in terms of what is the legal standard for who can be detained, as I talked about earlier, but also procedurally in terms of what sorts of evidence should be admissible in this sort of proceeding, what standard of proof should be applied. And these are all difficult questions that we know our habeas court are wrestling with at the moment. The last point that I want to make, so we have some time for questions, has to do with the repatriation question. And by repatriation, I mean what happens to fighters in conflicts with non-state actors at the end of hostilities. Well, it's not surprising that the law on non-international armed conflict is not really developed to answer this question. Traditionally, non-international armed conflict has been internal armed conflict, meaning fighting between nationals of the same state. So when fighting is over, I mean, there's no repatriation question. I mean, there may be a criminal sentence that continues to need to be served by the fighters, but at the end of the day, you're in your own country, you're released into your own country. And in fact, even in international armed conflict, there's not a well-developed body of law restricting repatriation at the end of conflict with respect to what happens to people when they return to their own country. The Third Geneva Convention contemplates return of enemy fighters immediately at the cessation of hostilities, with no specific provision made for holding individuals back or fear mistreatment upon repatriation, although state practice has evolved in a different way from that which we'll talk about later. There are some limited protections in the Fourth Geneva Convention for civilians with respect to repatriation. But because of this absence of law, U.S. in particular has already looked to human rights law to fill the gap. What the U.S. has been doing is, as a matter of policy, applying the Convention Against Torture Treatment Standard to repatriations at the end of hostilities, or put a different way, in hostilities with respect to a particular detainee. And practically, this means the U.S. does not return enemy fighters to countries where it's more likely than not that they will be tortured at the end when they are repatriated. And the one caveat, the one difficulty is, of course, in-country transfers, where the U.S. doesn't have a formal policy of not returning individuals where they'll be mistreated, but has nevertheless negotiated in both Afghanistan and Iraq transfer arrangements in which the home government is committing to humane treatment of their own nationals upon return to government custody. Well, if it appears that this example suggests that human rights can play an important and useful role in gap filling, I would suggest that the practical problems that have resulted from using this regime raise serious questions about how human rights is being applied in this context. Because the difficulty that the United States has confronted is, if you cannot repatriate detainees to their home country, what do you do with them? Well, one thing we know is you probably can't indefinitely detain them. Certainly in the United States, the Zedvitas decision has suggested that there are serious constitutional questions about indefinitely detaining aliens pending deportation when deportation is not imminently possible. And even outside the country, in the Kiemba case, where the Supreme Court actually took cert to answer the question as to whether the government could indefinitely detain an alien at Guantanamo Bay, where there was no reasonable prospect of repatriation, or whether they would have to, in fact, allow that detainee to be admitted into the United States for resettlement. Now, the Obama administration was able to move the case by finding homes for all of the Kiemba petitioners, but that question continues to fester, which is that it does not appear that indefinite detention is an answer if you can't repatriate. And in this context, the other general answer, which is third country resettlement, is also often not available because nobody wants to resettle suspected or actual former al-Qaeda terrorists, and this includes the United States. And so this problem is a big reason why Guantanamo is still open. So There certainly have been suggested some ways through this thicket. One has been the use of diplomatic assurances, which are promises from one country to the detaining country that if we take our national back, we won't mistreat this national. Now, the human rights community has been very skeptical of the use of diplomatic assurances because they suspect that a country that's already violating its international treatment obligations isn't any more likely to respect the bilateral promise to treat these returned detainees well. And they also have, I think, more rightly point to the fact that monitoring of diplomatic assurances is very difficult. Our friends, the British, have decided to respond to this problem through establishing a system of control orders, which are restrictions on liberty short of detention that allow an individual to be free in the United Kingdom, but they have restrictions on their movement, employment, friends that they can keep, contacts with certain people. But the British have been very frank about the fact that this is not even a second or third best option, and in fact have specifically stated that their view is control orders are relatively easily evaded, and unfortunately there are some relatively high profile cases of individuals who have disappeared from the radar of the British government while on control orders. And then lastly, the in-country transfer point, but really you see the limits of human rights law, because what do you do with an Iraqi national or an Afghan national that is in U.S. custody when the U.S. chooses to leave, or U.S. will leave, be asked to leave, and believes that this person will be mistreated by their government when they're turned over? I mean, there's not really any precedent for what you do. Do we bring those people back to the United States? What would be the legal authority for doing that? Is that consistent with the Fourth Geneva Convention? So ultimately, then, my takeaway from this is that while I certainly agree that application of human rights while fighting terrorism is important, especially in the treatment context, I think there are real questions about whether human rights law provides answers to the important questions that I've raised here, and where it does have answers, whether it's practical to employ those answers. Thanks.
Thank you, Vijay. I'm really struck by, in addition to the high quality of the remarks, by a comparison to some of the observations on the last panel, and I think I'll open up the discussion with a comment on that regard and then a question for the panelists, and then after that one question is batted around a bit, I'll open up the discussion to questions and comments from the audience. So what strikes me as being different is how, as we were reviewing the different relevant issues as each of our panelists were doing that, the diversity of the roles that international human rights law serves in the counterterrorism context. So for EJ, discussing the Security Council's process with regard to targeted sanctions, a slow evolution and a recognition that international human rights law does have a role to play, and indeed it ought to be institutionalized within the counterterrorism context and within the sanctions context. So there's kind of a welcoming idea that this is in some sense legitimizing the process that has been set up since September 11, 2011. Then Professor Cassel's remarks, here we see international human rights law as a constraint on specific actions at the domestic level with regard to counterterrorism strategies. And then the third approach that Vijay provided, as human rights law as a potential gap filler, may be the solution to some of the open questions that we heard about in the last panel. But in fact, sounding a note of caution that gap filling might itself be somewhat illusory, because we actually are not quite sure how the gaps would be filled and what the norms that would fill the gaps would actually look like. And so that the observation is what's missing among all those perspectives was some notion of international law as having a kind of enabling function. That is to say, as enabling or facilitating states to provide security for their citizens. And I think we heard in the last panel that there was this enabling function of international law, although we had a disagreement of when the constraining functions and enabling functions plan actually come into play. And I was struck, as Vijay was giving his remarks at the end, how in a case some of you may be familiar with, Saudi versus Italy, which was a repatriation case in the context of a risk that the repatriated individual would be subject to torture in, I believe in a case it was Tunisia, the United Kingdom argued before the European Court of Human Rights, which decided that case, that essentially we need, human rights law requires us to take measures in order to protect our citizens from terrorist violence. And the European Court of Human Rights saying, you're absolutely right, it does, but there are certain categorical prohibitions, certain actions, including returning an individual to a place where he or she is at risk of being subject to torture, that are simply non-derogable, not part of the conversation on human rights law. And so I was struck there with the missing kind of perspective of international law, and then also how in some of the areas where human rights law might fill gaps, it might be indeed too rigid. And so that leads to me to my question for the panelists, which is, again, drawing on the sort of where do we go from here question from the last panel, would it be possible, or would it be useful to try to think about developing some sort of multilateral regime that actually address the current problems and difficulties that the responses to a non-state actor terrorism are creating. So we have existing rules that we are trying to fit piecemeal to deal with a problem that is not entirely suitable, or I should say not entirely like the problems that the drafters of the various treaty regimes had in mind. And so one question is, do we try to take the wisdom from those prior regimes and try to come up with a common set of standards for dealing with new challenges? Or are we always going to be faced with the problem of applying pre-existing rules that don't perhaps have the suppleness and flexibility to deal with those problems? So that's the problem, that's the question that I'd like to throw out to the panelists, and then we will open it up for discussion. I don't know about any of the three of you want to start the conversation. EJ, please.
Well, thank you very much. I don't think it'll surprise anyone to hear that my perspective on some of these questions is in stark contrast to that expressed by Vijay, whose analytical approach I respect very much, but whose conclusions I strongly disagree with. I think that that this poses for us in very compelling terms the difficulty, first of all, of framing the international effort against terrorism in a war paradigm, and I think ultimately rather loosely applying a schematic of armed conflict to challenges which in many ways and in many contexts I think are amenable to a human rights approach. The Security Council has certainly recognized the relevance of IHL human rights law and refugee law to this question, but with respect particularly to the applicability of human rights law and the potential gaps that might exist, I would disagree with Vijay that human rights law is inadequate to the task. I think it's important, first of all, though, to mention a point which has been made by many other speakers, which is important, that there is a question of atmospherics and the way in which the nations of the world deal with the threat posed by terrorism. I think it's essential that an approach grounded in the rule of law unquestionably characterize our actions. In that respect, I would argue that not only in Europe, but in other parts of the world, certainly some of the policies that have been used, for example, by the U.S. Are viewed in quite a negative light, including the reliance on military commissions. Of course, in countries, for example, in North Africa and the Middle East, not all of them, but some of them, there is great reliance on military tribunals, which important that the approach be properly calibrated. And in that respect, although there are undoubtedly complex challenges that we're discussing here, I would argue that that human rights law is more nuanced and helpful than might be set out in, for example, the ICCPR, point by point. Obviously, we can't look only to the legislative authority, but we also need to look at the interpretation applied by international mechanisms, not only the Human Rights Committee, but, for example, the Working Group on Arbitrary Detention, which has decided hundreds of cases, often dealing with, or sometimes dealing with, security detention regimes, and has come up, or has concluded that detention is arbitrary and has enumerated the reasons for that. I think it's utterly essential that any discussion about security detention go beyond the threshold statement that it is acceptable under any circumstances, because it is what it says it is. It obviously needs to be demonstrated before an independent tribunal. And in that respect, for example, we have engaged in discussions with countries in, as I say, for example, Malaysia and Singapore, which have security detention regimes, which are subject strictly to essentially presidential commissions to determine the legitimacy of detention. I doubt that something like that would happen in this case, and I know that the expert lawyers in this room would be very much a part of a process to hopefully come up, if this issue comes on the table, to come up with perhaps some sort of security detention regime in this country which would more closely approximate the requirements of international law. But I think it's clear to say from an international perspective, as Doug pointed out, there's a strong prejudice against the notion of detention which might be open-ended and which is based on, not on particularized reasons for that detention. And just the last thing I would like to mention is with respect to this question of repatriation and the absence of law there as well. It is true that, as Professor Helfer pointed out, there is strong jurisprudence against return, including return based on diplomatic assurances, and the Saudi court, the European Court of Human Rights, rejected it in that case, but the court did not reject diplomatic assurances wholesale and kept the door open to the possibility that there might be a way to rely on diplomatic assurances as a means to transfer individuals. As a human rights advocate, I don't think I would go that far, but I know that there have been discussions, including with some of the leading luminaries of the human rights community who are in the Obama administration now, in which they insist that, you know, we have to talk about real life cases here. We can't be abstract. We can't pontificate on principles. And there are serious problems that the Obama administration is facing. But I am convinced that there are, these problems have to be resolved within the framework of rather detailed jurisprudence that the international mechanisms and, of course, the U.S.
Let me. All right, thank you. I'd like to answer Larry's question and then respond to your response to my comments. Sure, in theory, Larry, we could embark on an international negotiating effort to come up with a new instrument that would do a better job than existing law does of addressing these problems. One concern that should be shared by an American administration that professes to be supportive not only of effective efforts to combat terrorism, but also to respect human rights, is to look at the makeup of the negotiating partners in the world today and to ask the question whether the outcome of such a negotiation would leave us better off or worse off than we are today. One need only look at the voting lineup of the United Nations Human Rights Council, where the United States and other democracies all too frequently lose human rights battles, to be worried that a new instrument would leave us worse off rather than better off. Secondly, while we are thinking about whether we should venture into that uncharted and, I suspect, treacherous water, we need to comply with existing law. An existing law, while it does not answer all questions, as Vijay rightly points out, is, in my judgment, nowhere near as absent in response to the problems as you suggest, Vijay, with all respect. First, the two points you made specifically in response to me were, you suggested that the Geneva Conventions proposed that enemy combatants be prosecuted before military courts. It doesn't say military commissions. In fact, on the contrary, Article 102 of the Third Geneva Convention dealing with POWs grants prisoners of war the right to be tried by the, quote, same courts, end quote, using the, quote, same procedures, end quote, as would be used against members of the armed forces of the detaining power. What that tells you is that in an international armed conflict, if you're going to apply that rule, then the Al-Qaeda suspects are entitled to be tried before a United States military court-martial, not by a military commission. So the fact that we've been proposing all along to give foreign combatants second-class procedural treatment compared to what U.S. soldiers get has always been one of the human rights objections to military commissions. But beyond that, that provision itself suggesting trial by military court applies in an international armed conflict. And it makes sense where you have the soldiers of Germany being tried by the soldiers of the United States that they ought to get the same procedural guarantees. What's problematic in the effort to combat terrorism is we're not talking about people who wear German uniforms and can be easily identified when they're picked up on the field of battle. We're talking about people who wear civilian clothes, who are not always armed, who are often picked up and have been picked up and have then been taken to Guantanamo or Bagram from countries where there is no visible armed conflict taking place. And the only way those people get hauled into the laws of war is if you take the position that everybody anywhere in the world who is affiliated with Al-Qaeda is automatically part of an armed conflict. Now that poses the danger that all kinds of innocent people who are suspected on the basis of intelligence information, which we know is often wrong, of being terrorists, get thrown into the military court system and deprived of the rights that they properly are entitled to as civilians. So the suggestion that the Geneva Conventions somehow tell us that military courts are the answer is wrong on two counts, I think, military commissions. Second, you quite rightly point out that international perceptions need to be disaggregated. There was, in fact, some discussion about it yesterday. Deborah Perlstein, I think, made the point. And I agree with you. Certainly the reactions in Europe will be different from those in the Arab world. Many in the Arab world will not see any difference between a U.S. military trial and a U.S. civilian trial. But many of our allies would, and rightly so. And I think moderate people in the Arab world also, and in the Islamic world, would at least be open to discussion on that point. As far as the general inadequacies you suggest of international human rights law, they are nowhere near as deficient as you suggest. Is there a lack of uniform rules? On some points, yes. But on other points, there are uniform propositions that run universally throughout international human rights law. I spent most of my presentation talking about two of them, non-discrimination and impartiality of the courts. Is it difficult to make assertions of custom in the area of international human rights law because of variation in treaty commitments by different countries? On some issues, yes, but on many issues, no. Are derogations a problem which vitiates the possibility of answers from human rights law? Well, first of all, as you know, there are many rights which are not derogable. One of the key rights, which we insisted during the Guantanamo litigation was not derogable, was the right to be brought before a judge when you are detained under Article 9.4 of the ICPR. Application of human rights norms extraterritorially, you discuss it as if it's a contested terrain, you describe, between the United States and the Human Rights Committee. let's remember that the Human Rights Committee is consistent on this point with, as far as I can tell, the uniform judgment of all instances of international law, the International Court of Justice, the High Commissioner for Human Rights, all of the UN human rights bodies. I don't know of anybody who seriously contests the extraterritorial application of human rights law other than the United States and Israel. And when Israel did it, when Israel's position was at issue in the advisory opinion proceeding before the International Court of Justice, Israel's position on that point was unanimously rejected by all the judges of the International Court of Justice. So to suggest that when the U.S. government takes a position in its self-interest that happens to be contrary to what almost everybody else in the world is saying, that that somehow creates uncertainty in international human rights law is bootstrapping of the most unfortunate sort. So yes, you're right, that international human rights law doesn't give us all the answers, but it certainly can do a much greater portion of the job than you would allow it to.
Vijay?
Okay, well, several things I could say in response to all of that, but let's make some general points. First is, in response to your question, Larry, it never ceases, on some level, to amaze me at how insistent people want to be that existing law, as it currently sits, can answer all or most of the questions that we face today. And I actually appreciate, I think, the sentiment behind it, which I think is a lack of comfort with the reality that if there are legal gaps, there's going to be a move to abuse those gaps to do things that people view as incorrect. And I'd be the first to say that the Bush administration made a horrific error in identifying gaps, but then deciding to use those gaps to mistreat me. So I understand the discomfort with it, but that doesn't, in my mind, mean that you can therefore say that existing law fills all the gaps. And I think one of the consequences of that is there's an over-reliance on what can be called soft law. It's an over-reliance on what these UN working groups who start with what the treaty says, but then just start going off on their own, spinning forward, this adds on to this, adds on to this. Before you know it, you end up with a set of human rights obligations that look quite different from what any of the states that negotiated the agreement thought they looked like when they negotiated the agreement. So I will certainly posit that if we were to accept all of those soft law pronouncements as the state of the law, the volume of gaps or the depth of the gaps would be reduced. But I'm skeptical about whether it's or actually I'll go even further. I said I don't think it's necessarily appropriate to adopt that approach. Two other quick points. One is, you know, I think it's interesting this point about civilian versus military trials. I mean, I guess I am very skeptical that U.S. civilian trials actually provide any modicum of fair rights for a suspected al-Qaeda terrorist. Or put a different way, to think that a jury of New Yorkers sitting in the Southern District of New York is going to be any more impartial in adjudicating a murder claim against Khalid Sheikh Mohammed than is a military tribunal in response to a war crimes claim against him, I think belies the facts. I mean, look at the Padilla case where the government introduced what I think is exceedingly weak and speculative evidence and was able to secure a conviction from a civilian jury because of a range of reasons, but one can imagine because civilian juries are not going to be sympathetic. And then the second point is that the extent that there have been military commissions that have been informed, we've seen that military judges have been more willing to understand conduct related to battle or to adjacent to battle than I think a civilian jury. I'm not sure that a civilian jury would look at Hamdan's conduct, for example, with as benevolent an eye as a military judge did, because the military judge understood or had a better understanding of the armed conflict situation. Last point on the Saudi case. It certainly is the case that the human rights community, or not the human rights community, the European Court in that instance, suggested that assurances might be okay or didn't categorically rule them out. But if you actually look at the assurances the UK got, if those assurances are insufficient to meet the purposes of assurances, it's hard for me to contemplate what assurances would meet the standards. I mean, the British negotiate very robustly. robust standard, assurances that include very intrusive monitoring mechanisms. And I had the experience of negotiating diplomatic assurances when I worked at the State Department. I can tell you that we rarely, if ever, would succeed with those sorts of very intrusive demands because most countries aren't willing to agree that you can just bring your consular people into our prisons and run around them. It's an affront to their sovereignty to make those kinds of agreements. And so if something as intrusive and comprehensive as what the British are contemplating is insufficient, it's hard for me to see when the court would think they're sufficient.
Wonderful. Okay, I want to give a chance for those of you in the audience who have questions or comments to make them. And please wait until you get the microphones and identify yourselves. So I don't see any hands on these issues.
I'll go.
Sure. Over here, to my right.
Hi, Paul Rosenzweig. Red Branch Consulting, and I was a speaker yesterday on the cyber panel. I wanted to just offer a perspective on the Saadi case and the non-performant provisions that perhaps brings a bit more reality to the discussion. I was in the Department of Homeland Security, where I was acting Assistant Secretary for International Affairs, and we met often with our Interior Minister colleagues in Europe, and I well recall the case and its effect on Italian practices, which was that the Interior Minister told us that he now delayed signing the deportation order until just minutes before the person to be sent back to either Tunisia or Morocco was put on the plane, therefore depriving that individual of any right or any opportunity to challenge the illegality of his deportation. And what I took from that is that the rigidity of human rights law actually has, in some instances, not all, but in, at least in this one, the absolute perverse consequence of creating incentives for state actors to avoid their obligations. I think it demonstrated to me the certainty that in the end, state actors will try their best to do what they think is necessary for the defense of their sovereign self-interests, irrespective of the rigidities of human rights law. And if human rights law is inconsistent with those perceptions, there'll be ways on the ground. And I should add that this was the Interior Minister, not of the conservative Berlusconi government, but he was back in, I forget who that was, I forget the name of the Prime Minister.
Prodi.
It was Prodi's Christian Democrat and Interior Minister who was doing this. So it's not a liberal conservative left-right divide. And it just seems to me that when we elevate absolutes in the law in that kind of way, we're really just in the end buying ourselves more trouble and in the long run enhancing mechanisms that lead to a disrespect for the rule of law, which is of course exactly contrary to the initial purpose. I offer that not as a question, but really as a data point that is directly bears on.
Can I just jump on one very quick comment, which is just that it's amazing when you look at the scholarship in this area, the number of papers that actually start with or end with, okay, so there's this absolute prohibition, but we have no idea what practically we should do with this, because you end up with the very problem that you're describing, and academics and NGOs and international organizations pushing in that direction, but never answering the practical questions that you're raising.
There are comments or questions from the audience. In the middle of the back, in the white, please.
Hi, my name is Galit Raghuan. I'm a JSD candidate from Berkeley Law. I'm also an Israeli attorney. I wanted to hear maybe a little more about something that Professor Cassel mentioned in passing, and extraordinary rendition issue. Because I was surprised to hear that you said that the Obama administration would be continuing with it, obviously would augment it. And how human rights law comes into play with regard to that, because it seems, at least from previous OLC opinions, that customary international law did not get a lot of attention in the context of rendition. And it strikes me as ironic that when we talk about repatriation, all of a sudden it comes into play about how are we going to release these people to countries where they could be tortured, and that's led us to keep people perhaps in detention. But then it hasn't gotten as much of a focus in terms of transferring these people to third countries to begin with for interrogation purposes. So maybe you could comment about how human rights law comes into play in that aspect.
Well, human rights law under the Torture Convention and under more general principles of non-refoulement law does not permit a country to knowingly send someone to another country where there's a substantial probability they'll be tortured. U.S. law defines that as more likely than not. International law defines it as something along the lines of substantial probability. So you have the well-known case of Mr. Maher, a Canadian citizen who was detained, I think, at Kennedy Airport in New York by the United States, apparently, it's a little unclear, but apparently with some collaboration, at least from the Canadian intelligence agencies, but not the Canadian government at senior levels, and sent to Syria, presumably with written assurances that he would not be tortured. And he came back, ultimately alleging that he was tortured. The Canadians conducted an enormous investigation, concluded that he was tortured, awarded him a significant sum of money damages. The United States sent him there. So that's a very different question from when the United States has somebody in detention and we realize there's no need to detain him, but we can't find anywhere to send him, like the Uyghurs. That's a very different case than when the United States catches someone either on our territory or on a third country territory and sends that person to a country where the whole world knows that there is a record, a consistent, troubling, long-standing record of torturous behavior by the security forces, in this case Syria. There are other such countries. So that's where human rights law comes into play. It says you don't send people to places where you have pretty good reason to figure they're going to be tortured. And you also don't accept a piece of paper promising that they won't be tortured. I presume such a piece of paper was produced by Syria in the Maher case, because it was the stated policy of the U.S. government at the time to require such assurances.
Perhaps just to add on this question, definitely these issues are difficult, but no one has raised the possibility that maybe the policy of this government in the early days was unfortunate in that it condoned torture, and that actually some countries have made significant progress against the practice of torture. And there are a number of countries, not many, but which I think might represent a better model to put before a court with respect to a likelihood of ill treatment, particularly if, for example, they ratify the additional protocol to the Convention Against Torture, permitting a domestic surveillance of detention centers. So I think part of the problem here is we're premising this whole discussion on the absolute impossibility of making any progress against the practice of torture.
Other questions or comments? Yes, sir. No.
Hello, my name is Bob Anholm. I'm with an organization, nonprofit organization called Citizens for Global Solutions. Let me call attention to some what I would call characteristics of human nature that I think we haven't discussed but might benefit from considering. I think it's human nature sometimes to fall prey to doing what seems expedient in the short term, even while acknowledging that it's inconsistent with what you think is right in the long term. I think it's human nature sometimes to want to say publicly that you stand for something, but in fact privately to do something else. I think it's human nature sometimes to say there ought to be a general rule, but it doesn't apply to us. And that, it seems to me, is one of the problems that we need, or that category of human nature, if we can generalized. This is one of the problems we need to deal with in this era. I'm interested, as someone who believes in the rule of law, as someone who's a lawyer and has thought about some of these issues in my own life and my approach to public policy issues, at how little discussion there's been in the last 2 days about what would the United States think, or how would Americans feel if other countries were going through the same sort of analysis and reaching the same sorts of conclusions that we in the United States do. If another country treated some of our citizens in a certain way that we considered inappropriate, but then said to us, oh, you know, we've deliberated about this for weeks, we've thought about it very long and hard in secret, and we've concluded that what we're doing is just fine, I just don't think Americans would be very much reassured by that. So my question for the panel is to encourage you to revisit the point of what is the rule of law that ought to apply here? What are the rules that the United States ought to be governed by? And isn't it the case that part of the problem here was that there were very powerful people, and there are very powerful people in positions of power in our government who believe that we shouldn't be bound by international law at all, that the United States needs to be free to do what the United States thinks it needs to do. And I've heard high-level people in legal conferences basically say that, and say that that's not a power other countries have because they're just not that powerful. But we are, and that's the rule that applies to us. I think at some level, as lawyers, we need to confront the sort of might makes right that underlies a lot of the discussion that goes on. So I'd invite you to respond to that. Thank you.
You've understated the problem. And I'm serious. The problem with the last administration, or some of the lawyers in it, and some of the clients of those lawyers, was not merely that they regarded international law as a fiction not to be allowed to stand in the way of a great power, but that all law was just a meddlesome restraint on the unlimited power of the commander-in-chief to do whatever he thought was necessary to win a war. And you know who I'm talking about. And that theory is unbounded. And when that's your theory, you are not any longer limited by law, except to the limited extent the Constitution creates a commander-in-chief. Sure, in tough times, and people and countries confronted with terrorist threats are in tough times, the commitment, the basic cultural values commitment of the polity and of the legal profession and of those in government to the rule of law is sorely tested. It was tested, and by some people in the last administration, it failed. Fortunately, by others, it did not. TJAGs and the JAG lawyers are one example of people who stood up and protested and tried to set things right. Some of the legal advisors for the State Department attempted to do the same thing. So there were people who understood what this country is built on, who tried to protect it. And the courts stepped in on occasion. The Supreme Court basically had a calendar every 2 years it would rule against the Bush administration on those policies. And now in the Obama administration, as you know, I said their record is mixed. I have some concerns about it, but it seems to me the concerns I have with its positions are the kinds of issues where reasonable people can disagree. What I do see and what is most refreshing is that we have a government and a group of lawyers advising the government, which is committed to the rule of law and sometimes finds it very difficult how to apply the rule of law to a tough situation where the rules are not all that clear.
I know we need to end here, but I just want to have a 30-second spot, which is just to say, I agree with all of that, and I think that's why I get frustrated with this argument that we've been having, or that it's generally being had about whether existing law is sufficient or insufficient. I think we could move a lot more quickly towards resolving the problem of absence of law if we accepted the limitations of what currently exists and try to go about designing a regime that can better handle the current problems that we're facing, an international regime. And so ultimately, whether existing law is unclear or could be bent in a particular way, if we really arrived at a new regime, I think it would be a lot more
joining us at lunch to hear Bob Litt.